have not been held accountable. Many of them still have their jobs, still collecting a pension, still collecting a paycheck, and are still patrolling the streets. So we don't feel safe, and this verdict does not make us feel safe.
White men, maybe not. These are the things that we really have to deal with. This is a case that we will remember for a long time to come. Because prosecutor Mike Freeman, he doesn't prosecute police officers. We saw in this case that he was comfortable prosecuting a black man. In Minnesota, we have to recognize that the jury plays a real role. Jury members saw Justine DeMond as a victim because she was a white woman. We looked at this as a tragedy because a white woman was killed. Yet when black men and women have been killed in Minnesota, we vilified them. The media plays a real role in this as well, and we have to acknowledge it, and we have to correct it. It's time for us to stand together and start valuing human life, human dignity. It's time for us to all stand together and say, enough is enough. Don't let Justine DeMond's death be in vain. Let it mean something. Let us wake up and see it for what it really is. Let us not use Officer Knorr as a scapegoat and think that somehow the system is magically fixed, because it is not. Again, I want to remind us that injustice anywhere is a threat to justice everywhere, and that we all need to stand up and rise up for justice for all. Thank you.
To make it through those next weeks or months, you don't know how to navigate the system. This is not something that people encounter on a day-to-day basis, and the people who are out there that can help you are so rare. And so that's why I'm very happy to bring up this next person, Kimberly Handy Jones.
Oh, yeah.
I'm Michelle with Community United Against Police Brutality, and I need to get a couple of volunteers. Can I get two volunteers, please? I just need you to help hold this.
Justine DeMond, because she didn't deserve to die. But so many black men have died in the same manner, man. And in all actuality, man, the officers have got off. And this is an unusual dynamic, because the officer is black and the woman is white. Let's just say the officer was white and he killed the white woman. Would it have been the same? Why do we have to ask these questions when it's obvious what they showed us, right? They showed us yesterday exactly how it feels to be black going to court here in this state yesterday. You know, nobody had this officer's back, and nobody ever will. It's like that for black men all across the United States, man, when it comes to dealing with the judicial system here in this state of Minnesota. And not even in the state, but throughout the United States, man. You know, like, I've never seen a white woman killed by a police officer ever in my life. Ever. But what they showed us, that if it ever happens and it's a black officer, you don't have the same protections as these white officers at all. You know, the remedy to this is to stop training police to kill people. That's the remedy to it, right? And train them to be the damn police officers we used to have in the 70s and 80s, man. Train them to be them damn police officers who used to actually be welcomed in the community and be respected. You know, they used to roll up on the corner, tell us to get up off the corner, right? And we roll up off the corner because we respected the officers. Now we just got these thugs, man, and there's a lot of them coming from these suburban neighborhoods who have a racist agenda in mind, and that's the reason why they got the badge. So, you know, it's like a whole lot of systematical racism shit that I'm talking about, man. And pardon my English, man, but it just pissed me off simply because I had to deal with, you know, my good friend's mother, man, is like emotional about this shit, right?
Yeah.
Like emotional. It's up and down, up and down. Nobody should have to feel that way.
Yeah.
You know? So it's just crazy, man, how you know, it's overlooked. And if you don't bring attention to it, nobody will say anything. At the end of the day, it's going to happen again this summer. Yeah. It's going to happen. I promise you, it's going to happen again. It's going to be a whole different scenario. All right? I love y'all, man. All right. Appreciate you. Appreciate you.
Come to MTN, man.
All right.
We need some more of that. We can get that out there.
Okay.
So, this is Andrew. I was really surprised at the amount of coalition building that existed at this protest. I was coming into it initially thinking that they were going to be primarily celebrating the fact that justice had been served against police officers inside the Minneapolis area, an area that's been, well, definitely remarkable and infamous for police brutality that has been unlooked and unaccounted for. Today, we had a number of different communities gather together in order to discuss these subjects and talk about how this isn't the first step. It's not the last step. It's an ongoing process that the entire community is going to be holding the police force accountable for their actions, and that this one indictment of a black police officer for killing a white woman is more indicative of the protection that we put towards what we view as the tribe, and thankfully it set a precedent that can be used in other cases in order to solve and hold police accountable for the actions that they commit against the citizens that they allegedly serve. Again, this is Andrew Schumacher. Have a good night.
Now, for a long time, as the Twin Cities Coalition for Justice for Jamar, this group has been out here ever since Jamar Clark was killed as he stood by an ambulance trying to... Okay, good evening, everyone. Raise your hand if you can hear me. Raise your hand if you can hear me. Raise your hand if you can hear me.
You gotta go, yeah, this is a long one. You might have to go down to the front of the crowd, because I'll tell you something. This is our Stolen Lives banner. This banner is 45... 45-